Started, a very wise man once told me, always start meetings on time. So that's what I'll do. Welcome, everyone, to the Minnesota GOP Where Do We Go From Here event of the Blue Fox. I'd like to thank you. Yeah, sure, go ahead. You can applaud. I'd like to say a couple of quick announcements. For starters, remember, waitresses, wait staff, have the right of way. Make sure you tip well as well. Make sure that everyone gets fed and watered up here good here for the course of the evening. And thanks, of course, to the good folks of the Blue Fox who have been great at sponsoring and allowing events out of this wonderful space. Thank you, Blue Fox. A lot of different people from a lot of different factions of the Republican world here. I think we can all agree on a couple of things. A, Republicans tip well, make sure you do. B, wherever it is that you stand on politics, I'd urge you to remember our sometimes friends, sometimes adversary, Michael Broadkorb, in your prayers. He's still duking it out there and giving it a good fight, so by all means, remember him if you could, please. And finally, hope you all have a great time tonight. Just one quick announcement. Again, the little 3x5 index cards are where you write your questions. I'll be going through the ground rules in just a minute here, but without any further ado, just to kick things off, I'd like to introduce the co-moderator for the evening from the Hennepin County Commission, Jeff Johnson.
Thank you, Mitch. Well, welcome to everybody, and thank you for being here tonight. I do have to share one thing. I don't know if anybody was listening to the... I don't know if anybody was listening to the radio on the way over here or not, but it is amazing to me what the media wants us to know about our president. I don't know if you heard, but you know they were making a big deal today that he had his annual physical and that everything is okay, and they also insisted on letting us know that he had his first colonoscopy this year, and some of us have not had the privilege of that. But good news, everything was fine. They did have to pull a couple of New York Times reporters out of there, but otherwise, everything was good. So welcome to everyone. A couple of housekeeping items, a couple of thank yous before we get started, before we introduce our panelists. First of all, live streaming services are being provided tonight by Central Media Services, which is a company owned by Eric Ekstrand. So he deserves a thank you for allowing us to do that tonight. And the live stream will be available both on True North and on Real Capital View. Also, we want to thank our sponsors tonight for their help in making this event possible. They are True North, Real Capital View, Brandon and Stacy Sawalich, and Chris Andresky, and also a thank you to Nancy LaRoche and Michelle Mankey for putting together the flyer. So let's give them all a round of applause. And then finally, some of you know Steve Hensley and some of you don't, but this was his idea. He's the one who put it together. He's the one who called all of us, and he's the one who's done most of the marketing. So big thank you to Steve for that. All right, I'm going to introduce the panelists in a minute, but before I do that, I just want to say one thing, and then Mitch will go over the ground rules. I'm very excited about tonight. I think it's going to go great, but there are some people who think that tonight is going to be a bit of a train wreck, and I think you all know that. There are some people who are worried about that. There's some in the media who are here tonight that are probably hoping that we have a little bit of a train wreck tonight. And there are certainly some of our non-Republican friends who are praying that we beat the hell out of each other and that we yell and scream and do something embarrassing so that they can see it in the paper tomorrow and so that we leave more divided than we came. Just one request of you, let's not do that tonight, okay? And that goes to the panelists, it goes to everybody else here. Let's show that we are a party who actually values a debate and a discussion about ideas, unlike the DFL, which tries to shut you down whenever you disagree with them. And let's kind of model that tonight. I have seen some chatter on Facebook the last 2-3 weeks about some folks who think it might be fun or funny to heckle or to boo or to blurt something out when someone is trying to speak. And my request of you is to either control yourself and not do that, or if you don't think you can, to please leave, because you're really not adding anything to the debate tonight. That's as tough as I'll be. He's the bouncer. I'm a lover. He's a fighter. So if you're looking for toughness, it's going to come from Mitch tonight. But honestly, let's just try to treat everybody with respect tonight and understand that we may be coming from different places, and I think we're going to have a great night. So I'll turn it over to Mitch for our ground rules.
And there aren't that many of them. Basically, how it's going to work is this. You've got the question forms, the 3x5 index cards. Write your questions on that. We thought we'd do that then rather than have people line up to get on a microphone, because it's just not that much room here, and that way we can make sure all the questions get answered as much as possible. When a question comes up, I'll just pose it to the panel. We will, Jeff and I will alternate questions. We'll pose it to the panel. Anybody who wants to ask their question, just raise your hand, grab a mic, jump in on it here. No one's going to be required to answer a question, although if somebody's sitting and being terribly quiet, as we know Maryanne is prone to doing, we might just urge her to respond at some point here. But in the meantime, it'll just be a free-form discussion with people on the panel. We'll just ask the broadest assortment of questions we can. Ask people to keep their responses down to a minute or thereabouts here, just so we can get in as much as we can, as long as the energy keeps going here. So keep the questions coming up to the front. Steve Hensley will have his minions out there gathering them, so just keep them on coming. And with that, I'll go back to Jeff here.
All right. Well, we are going to start with opening statements from each of our panelists, and we've asked them to keep it to around 90 seconds or so. And I'm not going to give a long introduction of anybody. I will just introduce as we go down the line, and then let you, if you want to add more about your background, that's fine. So we'll start out with Maryanne Stebbins, who was the Ron Paul Minnesota chairman for 2012. Maryanne.
Thanks, Jeff. I do hope we can all learn a lot here tonight. What we need to come out of this with is, look, we don't have enough Republicans in the state of Minnesota to be able to win elections by just courting the Republicans. We need to actually get into the heads of the independents out there. The independents outnumber the Republicans and the Democrats individually. We need to get into their heads and understand where do we agree? You know, where can we agree on less government? And how can we, decrease the government's footprint by coming together with perhaps some independents and Democrats? And I've been talking to some Democrats, and I've had the chance over the Ron Paul campaign to learn a little more about where they're coming from. And they're not always all for bigger government. So let's find out. Hopefully I can add a little more insight as we go through the questions about, how can we appeal to some others out there than just the Republicans?
Thank you, Maryanne. Next, we have Mark Westpfahl, who's chairman of our Congressional District 2 Republicans. Mark?
Hi, thank you for inviting me on the panel tonight. Thank you. Jeff has reminded me that I'm not allowed to streak at this event, so that's a plus for everybody. Well, thank you. I appreciate that. One of the biggest lessons I hope we learn as a Republican Party, and I hope we can develop ways to do this, is to be open to the different perspectives, not only from within our party, but actively listening to the Democrats to figure out why is it that they want to actually do the things that they want to do. If we're not willing to listen to what our opposition is saying, we're looking at the chessboard with only one or two pieces in mind of our own pieces. We need to be able to look beyond our own pieces. We need to find that there is an opponent, which is oftentimes the DFL, but not always. And all that open space in the middle is the independent voices that are waiting to see, what are we going to do? Are we going to act like immature people? Are we going to act more in a childish way? Because that's not the way that we're going to be able to influence people to our views. The last thing is that we really need to open up more educational forums, not just on education, but allowing the DFL, allowing independent groups to share a stage with us to have that open dialogue. Otherwise, we're kidding ourselves.
Thank you, Mark. Next is Dan Severson. Dan and I served together in the House, and he's now president of the Minority Liberty Alliance. Dan?
Thanks, Jeff. And I want to kind of piggyback on what's been said already. If we take a look at Minnesota, the changing demographics and why Minority Liberty Alliance is such an essential part of the Republican future, the conservative future. In 1990, we had 6% of the population made up minorities in Minnesota. In 2008, 17%. Now, when you start to break that down, if you have 40% of that 17% that are voting, just voting, and that's a conservative effort, you're talking around 300,000 to 400,000 votes that are being captured by the Democratic Party because our party has refused to participate in the dialogue. And when I've gone to these communities, what I hear is, where have you been? And so when you start to talk about their values, you start to talk about what's important to them, you talk about life, pro-life, you talk about traditional marriage, you talk about education, you talk about small business, that's what they believe. But they don't know the Republican Party embodies those in our platform. I'm not saying we need to water down our message. I'm saying we need to expand our base. And doing that means to go to these minority communities and tell them what we stand for, and they will join us.
Thank you, Dan. Next, we have Sarah Janecek, who has been a Republican strategist and activist for a long time. Sarah?
Thank you, Jeff. Yes, I have. I'm a little concerned. The last time I was in a bar that was this hot, filled with this many Republicans, it was in June of the gubernatorial race, and I was moderating, and that's when Tom Emmer got hit with all those pennies. So I hope I hope that guy's not here tonight. All right, my opening statement is pretty simple. There was discussion on Facebook. I was asked to be here because I'm the moderate Republican. And we have Tea Partiers and we have social cons, social conservatives for those in the media. And my point is this. We're sitting here as a minority party for most of my life in Minnesota. We've been the minority party. Maybe it's time to set aside the labels because Rome is burning. And I think for me, that's best encapsulated with a bit I heard on NPR last week that breast pumps are covered by Obamacare, and it doesn't matter what kind of breast pump you order. You can order the Cadillac. Nobody thought that through. Rome is burning. So let's quit this. We don't like her because she's a Tea Partier. We don't like him because he's a social con. Let's focus on the big ball game, which is fiscal policy. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you, Sarah. Next, we have Walter Hudson, who is with the Minority Liberty Alliance as well, and is a blogger and writer extraordinaire. Walter.
Thank you, Jeff. I've been involved with the Republican Party for a relatively short period of time compared to the other folks up here today and many of you out there. And so I see myself as not just being a representative of the Minority Liberty Alliance and minorities in general, but also being representative of new activists and people who are interested, people who are politically curious but not necessarily involved yet, because I've recently taken that path into the party. And what concerns me is that there is no path that's being pointed to get into the party. You know, there are a lot of people out there who care about what's going on in the world, they care about what's going on in their country, but they don't know what to do about it. And you know, it takes a certain type of personality to forge a path that does not exist into the destination, which for our purposes is the Republican Party. People shouldn't have to be bushwhacking and blaze trailing in order to get here. We should be painting a clear path to activism. And so that's what I hope we'll end up doing tonight. One last point I'd like to make. I think we need to separate out the political task that the Republican Party has of attracting enough people in order to win elections, attracting enough votes in order to have political victory, from the cultural task of convincing people of the correctness of our ideology. Those are two separate issues. And if we separate them out and outside of the party structure, work on the culture within our sphere of influence to get people to believe what we believe, that'll make the political task much easier. Thank you.
Thank you, Walter. Next, we have campaign strategist Andy Parrish. Andy?
Well, I'm actually gonna start making the evening fun because I'm gonna fundamentally say what we just heard tonight is what's caused our party's demise in the first place. We've abandoned our principles. We don't stand for anything. We laugh at the Democrats when they take God out of their platform at the national convention. But look, we've done that already. We just leave his name in there. But we don't stand for anything anymore. And from a tactical standpoint, you know, I'll just say it. I managed the marriage amendment. We got beat. Everybody looks to say why we lost. We got beat. We got outplayed. we have not adapted the way we do things. I mean, my house got door knocked. My house, of all houses, I've been at this professionally for 12 years. I got door knocked by a field staffer. They didn't have it. They asked me a bunch of questions. They didn't even write anything down. I mean, we still campaign like it's 1980. And so unless we get back to what we originally were founded on, and unless we teach people the right way to deliver a message, to frame a message, and how to target people, how to win precincts, we're going to continue to lose. We've got a great message. We've got a great story. But unless we have the fundamentals there, we're going to continue to lose. Thank you.
Danny. And finally, last but not least, at the end, we have Erin Haust. Erin?
Hi there. Thanks so much for having me tonight. I understand it was short notice, and I'm filling some really big shoes. Senator Dave Thompson couldn't be here tonight, so I'll do my best. I'm what you would call, or what Andrew Breitbart called, a political junkie. Essentially, I got started in about 2008 and decided that it was no longer okay to just sit on the sidelines, that if I was unhappy, I needed to get off my couch and do something. And so I got involved with the party specifically to help change things from within, because in my opinion, we're going kind of like several folks up here have said, kind of doing the same thing over and over again every single election cycle. It's not enough to door knock anymore. We have to take control of social media. You'll find me on Twitter at Erin Haust. Please go there. You'll find me at conservativedailynews.com. We have to take over the internet. We have to take over new media. We're never going to win the mainstream media. We get that. But one of the things that as a party and certainly as activists we need to do is be more vocal online. Thanks.
All right, thank you, Erin.
All right, just a quick reminder here, if you have questions, wave the 3x5 index cards up in the air. Steve and his minions will be out looking for questions. We have minions, right? We only got the one minion. Well, wave energetically so our single minion, which is Steve, can find them. They'll get them up here. We will edit through them quickly as possible and get straight to it. Jeff and I are going to tee things up here with one question each for the entire audience. I think I'll start down there with Erin this time just to even things up a little bit. We just scoot down here for a minute real quickly. This event is billed as a look back and a look forward, but I'd like to focus mostly on looking forward, but just to get it on the table here, if you could change one thing about the way the party or your part of the party approached this last campaign, one thing, what would you do? Go.
There's so many. I think if I could change one thing, I'll just reiterate what I already said. We absolutely got crushed when it came to new media and the ability to communicate with other people within our party and other activists, forming coalitions with other groups that do the same thing we do. We don't share lists, we don't share names, we don't share information with anybody other than our own little BPOU or our CD or up at the state level. It's like pulling teeth to get some information. So in my opinion, the one thing that where we get beat every single time. They have coalitions on the left and they work together. You don't hear them complaining about, oh, well, he has a list and he has a list, but we can't get them to come together. They share. And it's about time that we start sharing as well.
Andy Parrish.
There's a book I highly encourage everybody to read called The Blueprint, How the Democrats Won Colorado. And read it because you'll find some very interesting things. You had four gay billionaires that decided they were going to make change at a social level for gay activists. And they literally poured money in and they did what Erin said. Let's get Democrats elected because we're all better off when Democrats get elected and then we can have a discussion about the policy. They never once talked about policy. They raised the money. They had all the technology in the world. They kept pouring more money in, and they turned Colorado from a solidly red state to a blue state. And they came here in Minnesota. It's funny, the group they formed was called Alliance for a Better Colorado. Does that sound familiar? Another group they formed was Coloradans United for All Families. Does that sound like a familiar group? And the bottom line is, Erin hit the nail on the head. Democrats play well together. We don't. We don't share our data. We don't have reliable data. We don't share donor lists. We don't coordinate, which is a dirty word in my world as a campaign hack. But when it comes to 527s and different things, they can coordinate. And one group was responsible for door knocking, another one phone calls, another one mail, and they ran a solid campaign. And that happened here. They came here in their book. They said they were going to come here. They came here, and they cleaned our clocks. And until we get together and decide, first of all, we're better off with Republicans in power, then we'll have the policy debate. We're going to continue to lose.
Walter Hudson.
The one thing I focus on is it's messaging, but it's not messaging just in the sense of trying to find a creative way to say the same thing. I think we need to look at the root of what it is that we're trying to get out there to the electorate. And I think it has to be, you know, as conservatives, you know, whatever label you want to apply to it as the right, we tend to be very analytical, we tend to be intellectual, we tend to think in terms of, well, that's not going to work because of this math I just did on this napkin. But that's not going to convince anybody. What convinces people is emotionally appealing moral arguments. We need to be willing to stand up and emphatically argue morally for individual rights. Until we're willing to do that, we're not going to have a message that actually gets down inside of people where they live and pulls them up out of their seat. All that we're going to be appealing to their brain, and their gears will be turning up there thinking about budgets and numbers. But when the DFL or the left comes talking about the moral reason why we need to have universal health care, their version of a moral reason, it's going to be more appealing because people like to be good. They like to think of themselves as being good. We need to explain why our policies are morally good.
Sir Janecek.
And just to refresh everyone's memory, the question was, what would you change in the last cycle or the last?
Last cycle, sure.
What I would change in the last 20 years is let's get the hell off the social issues. And you should know I get along great with a lot of social conservatives, but how many elections are we winning in the last 20 years? As some of you may know, I wrote a piece from the heart against the gay marriage amendment. Who read that? I had a bachelor farmer uncle who lived with a partner a couple farms down. They had to keep it hidden all their lives. That thing went viral. And not only did that thing go viral across the country, but that thing went viral in our party. And I cannot tell you how many well-respected, social conservative Republican men called me, wrote me 3-page emails to say thank you. And so I started out earlier saying Rome is burning. Let's get the hell off the social issues and focus on the fiscal ones and win some elections. Because if you go back to everything that Ronald Reagan said and wrote, it was the fiscal issues he was concerned about.
Dan Severson.
Well, this kind of pulls everybody who's in here in. And, you know, I did something I'd never done before. I've been running for office before. But this time, I went down and did poll watching down in the heart of the beast. I was down in the Brian Coyle Center, and I had two Somali friends who were with me. And we were down there watching what was going on. When they found out we were Republican poll watchers, they said, you go stand over here. And the bottom line was, I had both of these Somalis file complaints because one of the interpreters was saying to each one that came in there, here's the Democrats, here's the Republicans, the Democrats are our friends, don't even worry about who's running on the Republican side, just vote Democrat. Now this was to all of the Somalis that were lined up outside the door because of the social issue that Sarah's talking about. We had gone into that community and said, you know what? This is about family values. This is about what's important to your family and your culture. And they turned out in droves. Now, the problem was they knew how to vote now on the marriage amendment, and they were voting against or for the marriage amendment, but they were voting for the Democrats as well. We need poll watchers, and we need election judges that will step up to the plate in these high population diverse areas and get down there and be the feet on the ground and hold the system accountable. We got a broken system. And we need more people to engage in that.
Mark Westpfahl.
Andy made a great point about the PACs that are out there right now. And obviously the Democrats have more PACs that are aligned to their values, which puts our party at a disadvantage right away. Because automatically, the Republican Party, especially in Minnesota, is on the defense. And we have to justify our areas instead of motivating a base to go out for the ideas that we want to do. But as soon as we go out on the offensive, we become the group that's kind of a little bit whiny because we're so defensive, as Walter kind of mentioned, we're crunching the numbers at every turn and making it as realistic as possible, knowing that everyone in this room cares about politics. But when you have 40 to 50 to 60% of Minnesotans who aren't engaged on a daily basis and don't take the time or know where to get that information to get as detailed as we are, we look like we're taking our ball and running home on a lot of these issues. So understanding that we are playing a different type of game with the political PACs that are out there, we need to figure out how we can actually message the way that's not negative, but it's positive, and still be able to defend our stances and turn that around into a positive.
Next, Maryanne Stebbins.
What would I have changed about the last election cycle? There are two things. One, get in touch with the voters. We had an economy that was crumbling out there. And what are we out there talking about? We're talking about voter ID. Nobody cared about voter ID, regardless of whether it's right or wrong. That's what we were leading with, and that's not where people were. They were dealing with losing jobs. They were dealing with trying to meet their bills. And the marriage amendment, too, again, regardless of where you stood on it, didn't affect most people. That's not where they were. It's the economics. And we weren't talking about that. We were leading with the marriage amendment. We were leading with voter ID, and nobody cared about it. The other thing I would have changed is the legislature. When we had the majority of the Minnesota legislature, did we act like the party of small government? We think we're the party of small government. They don't see it out there. Because at the federal level, we're voting for bigger and more defense. We think that liberals think there's no amount of money too great to spend on education. They think that Republicans think there is no amount of money that's too great to throw at the Pentagon. So if we're going to be serious about being the party of small government, we have to act like it, because that message is not getting across.
Can I quick respond to a couple items since I was the campaign manager of the marriage amendment?
Andy?
One, I can't remember the last time the taxes won 75 of 87 counties. I can't remember the last time. I mean, I've got the statistics here. People love to blame the marriage amendment, but they have absolutely no proof to back that up. We won 75 of 87 counties in 10 seats where the DFL won a Senate seat. In 10 of them, the marriage amendment outperformed the Democrat and it outperformed the Republican. Until we sit back and say, look, we got beat, we got outplayed, we're going to continue this cycle. And Sarah, the social issue, the fiscal issues, I mean, how'd that work out for Romney, or the fiscal issues? It didn't. You know, how did it work out for Tim Pawlenty in Iowa? How did it work out for all? It didn't work. Nobody door knocks based off taxes. They door knock for life. I'm sorry, I'm not willing to forget about little babies that have been slaughtered, 50 million of them, because to win an election. I'm
all
just
right,
not.
I get to respond to that. A couple of things. I may be a moderate on social issues. But you know something? I bet I agree with all the social conservatives here that abortion should never have been decided by the Supreme Court. And so maybe there's value in going back to that conversation, because I think there's a lot more we agree with, that these things should be, these things that are controversial, the so-called social issues, should probably be decided by the people. Now, on the other hand, let's talk about Iowa. Pawlenty and Bachman was a fight to the right. That's all that was. And you can focus on all the stats you want, Andy, and I know you're smart and you're good and I respect you, but the bottom line is we are losing the PR war because we are worried about marriage amendment when people are trying to figure out how the hell they're going to pay for Obamacare.
All right. So we disagree on the marriage amendment somewhat, and that's okay. All right, I've got a question. I'll just open this up to anybody. We don't have to go down the line. Whoever wants to answer, just pick up the microphone, and we'll do that the rest of the night. And then we're going to, after my question, we'll start asking all of your questions. But how do you explain to the average independent voter, maybe somebody who doesn't pay a lot of attention but still votes, and there's a lot of those out there, how do you explain to them why conservative policies are better than liberal policies for them?
Well, what are conservative policies? Maybe we'd like to agree that it's decreasing the government footprint. If that's true, then we need to be consistent about it. And I'll come back to, these civil liberties issues, or, why do Republicans think that we have to, have bases in 130 countries around the world? We're not credible on being the party of small government. And so until we start talking about actually decreasing the impact that government has on people's lives, we're not going to be credible. Yes, we can talk about fiscal issues, and we're not even necessarily credible there. So we're going to have to start acting like the party of smaller government, if we're going to convince anyone that, we deserve those votes.
Erin?
I'm going to jump in here. You know, we can talk about what to talk about all day long. We can talk about platform. We can talk about, that's all stuff for the convention. I think if we really want to make a difference in how we move forward, we have to talk about tactical things. You know, how do we convince people? Through humor, through social media, through conversations at the dinner table. You're on your way to a movie and they say, do you want to go see Zero Dark Thirty or do you want to watch the latest Adam Sandler throwing his head up against a wall movie? Oh, I think I'd rather go see Zero Dark Thirty. I mean, we have choices to make every single day to engage in conversation or to not engage in conversation when it comes to our values and when it comes to what we stand for and who we should vote for and, you know, what are the issues on the, of the day. From a tactical standpoint, I think it's very, very important that we use things that the low information voters, and I don't mean that in a negative way. I mean, there are people out there who just don't pay attention, who watch The View, who watch Saturday Night Live, who watch Jon Stewart, and that's where they get their news. Engage those people. Believe it or not, they probably agree with you 80% of the time. They just don't know it. Because what we are painted as in every facet of media is something different than what they can relate to. So from a tactical standpoint, we can talk about what we want to talk about all day long, but I think it's important to also inject humor, inject social media, inject regular conversations with regular people.
Sarah, and then Mark, and then Andy.
I've thought about this for a long time, and I can't believe what has happened to me in the last few months. I have been accosted by people, and let me talk about the couple at Kentucky Fried Chicken off the Alexandria exit. I was on my way up to the lake when it was really cold. There's no heat. I had to spend the night over there just living off a fire, which was kind of fun. I walk in there with no makeup. I'm looking like hell. I'm accosted by a couple of farm couples, and their recurring line was, what will we do? Who's thinking about us? And the conversation, I sat with those people for half an hour. And the conversation was a great example of a conversation that's kind of happening all across the country that we can capitalize on. And that is that there's not, and those couples were self-supporting farm families who, you know, their property is extremely highly valued now. They've got a couple generations into the farm, and their point was, we can't afford to work for all the people that we have to pay for. The system cannot sustain itself anymore. I mean, that's why Romney's 47% was so unfortunate. He should have separated it out. Yes, there are people, and God bless, I'll collect my Social Security, as will all of you, as will a disability if you earned it. But damn it, when it was 1960 when I was born, there were less than a third of the people on entitlements. Right now, it's over two-thirds. That's not sustainable. And so I think the message for Republicans is we have to appeal to the people who are actually doing the work, providing something in the private sector, because they know, and we all know, they cannot sustain the system that we are on.
Mark? There's a couple of different factors that go with that. One being, a lot of people don't realize how much they really pay in taxes. And in the modern world of our paychecks going into direct deposit and not knowing what's coming out, your trash bill going to a direct deposit, so now you don't know how much you're paying for your trash service, and all these additional taxes. So we hear that a city wants to add in an extra $48. It doesn't sound like much. Then you add on the county that has three or four small taxes, now the state, now the feds. But I don't think a lot of people realize how much of their hard-earned money is actually being taken away from what they're doing. Several people have pointed out tonight that, you know, you need to work usually till August, September, October, or even November in a lot of people's instances before they've made enough money to live off of that money, because everything else prior has gone to taxes. But until we can engage with people and listen to why are they distrustful of government, why are they distrustful of parties, and get those stories so we can share examples. All right, here's what you could do to look into this. I have a friend who's in the same boat. Maybe you should talk to that person. When we become the caring party that the Republican Party was based on when it was founded prior to the Civil War and expanded and expanded and expanded, we're going to lose ground, because right now we appear to be all about us. We need to be inclusive and let people say, what about you? What are your concerns? Let me tell you an example about that.
Andy?
Yeah. No, that's all the stuff we're talking about is great. You know, we got to talk about the policy and how we're going to communicate. And personally, I don't care for public policy. You know, I wake up and think, how can I kick Democrats in the teeth today? But the very basics of a campaign, I've run a lot of campaigns at some of the highest levels. And a lot of the stuff that happens, you guys don't see because you see what our friends in the media report. You see what's on TV, but the basic fundamentals of a campaign structure are just not here in Minnesota. We don't do voter identification, and if we do, we don't do it well. We don't know how to micro-target precincts. We don't know how to deliver a message. And until we get that part done, we can't even have the policy discussion. And so I'm all for the policy discussion. That's for smarter people than me. I went to school in Wisconsin. Don't count on me for much. But I'm just going to tell you that until the problem is any campaign hack that's worth anything, you know, that knows how to set up a voter ID database, that knows how to go in and precinct target, that knows how the four boxes of messaging and how the four boxes of messaging works and how to deliver that, unless we have that foundation, we're going to continue to lose. And the campaign hacks that are worth anything, they're all gone now. And they've all gone to the private sector. They've all gone to get paid, which, you know what, if you live this life like Erin and I or Sarah and I have for 10, 12, 15 years, you do deserve to get paid. But we need to just at the very core put the foundation down of a campaign structure and then have the policy debate. So, and we also need to agree that we're better off with Republicans in power before we have a, you know, I used to be a purist where you had to be pure on every issue out there. We need to modify that as well. I mean, there are issues we can't give on, but we have to decide we're better off with Republicans than have the policy debate.
I'll second that, Andy. Would you ever vote for somebody who's pro-choice?
No. I said the purist test, Sarah, needed to be modified. But at its very core, look, I'm a pro-life from conception till natural death. That's who I am as an individual. But there are things that I can give on. There are things I don't care about. There are campaign finance votes that get taken that I could care less about because we all know we're going to jail someday if we stay in it long enough. And so what I'm saying is there are things we can give on. But you know, there are some things we can't give on.
And my point is that the things that people are unwilling to give on are why we have been a majority party majority of my adult life. A minority party.
So we disagree on abortion too.
I just want to
Sarah and I have known each other a long time. We're okay people.
But again,
we're not going to fight.
But again, I think the point, I go back to an earlier point. On the social issues, a lot of the moderate Republicans, which I'm the only one up here, right? We all agree on certain things, that things have been decided in the courts that should not have been decided in the courts that should have been decided by elected people. So maybe we can set that stuff aside and, you know, agree that some of that stuff should be decided by elected bodies. But we're losing elections. We're going broke. Maybe set the social issues aside. Can we just have a pact? Let's set them aside for 10 years and come back and see what happens.
No. All right. No, I'm not going to put babies aside for 10 years. But just as a, and then I'll stop after this. But my point is, let's have that discussion after we get the Republicans elected. Let's agree we're better off with Republicans in power. Let's get them elected, and then we can have those discussions, Sarah.
All right. We got Maryanne, and then Walter, and then I think we'll move on.
I'm just going to come back to something Andy was saying about operations, and I'm going to agree with him here. You know, with the Ron Paul campaign, we had asked the party if we could use Phoenix, the list, to call through it, because we were going to be doing IDing, issue IDing. You know, we could have done a whole lot of work in beefing up that list and building that list, but we met stumbling block after stumbling block with the party. So Erin also touched on this. Yeah, we do need to be getting that list out to campaigns and letting them do the work to build up those lists.
Walter? I just want to go back briefly to, I caught a little theme there talking about we need to talk to people, independent people who are productive, who are the ones who are paying the taxes. I think it's a mistake, and this is a recent thought of mine. It's untested, so I'm throwing it out there for your judgment, all right? I think we need to not limit ourselves to people who are paying taxes. There is a message that we can aim at folks who are not paying taxes. And that message is, do you really want this artificially imposed glass ceiling on your success? Do you really want to be limited in terms of how much success you can have, what you can achieve, what you can pass on to your children? You know, when we stop talking about welfare and entitlements in terms of handouts and start talking about them in terms of this cap, you're never going to get rich with a government check, right? Unless you're at a certain level, big corporation level. But, you know, as an individual person, you're never going to get rich on a government check. That's a message that hasn't been tried before.
I think we'll move on to the next question here. By the way, just a couple bits of housekeeping. If you need a question card, just wave your hand and the minion will swoop in here. Steve, I should stop calling him the minion. By the way, we got a great crowd here tonight, counted up close to 250 or 300 people, or as the Stribble reported, dozens. So thank you all for coming out. Next question, and for anyone who wishes to get in on it, I hope there's nobody from the Strip here. That would be embarrassing. This one, ironically, I got about five different versions of this one here, and I'll quote, I'm probably one of about 10 people here under the age of 30. The GOP has failed with the young generation. How can we change this? Let's start down on the... who wants to jump in on that one? Erin, we can... Well, Mark is here. We can... Mark here.
Walter, you're born in 78, so jeez. What month?
November.
I'm December, so despite my bald hair, I'm the youngest person on this panel. I'm 34 years old.
I was born in 79.
Oh. I got nothing.
And you're all babies.
One of the things that we did in CD2 this past year when we had our annual Reagan dinner is we reached out to the college Republicans. A young lady named Anna Peterson is absolutely an amazing, energetic woman. Yet, we don't listen to the college Republicans or the college voices that often because what life experience do they really have? That's the theme that's out there. But we need to engage those folks because they're the ones who are reaching out to their peers, seeing what their Democratic opponents are talking about and realizing how false these hopes and promises are that they're being wished upon. So we need to do a better job of reaching out to the colleges. Obviously, there's so many different levels, the messaging, all of that. Yes, you do have to have a solid message. But until we're willing to invite people that are younger into the party and say, what do you like to do and what are your talents? Because frankly, there's a lot of people that don't want to get involved in our party that are new because I don't want to make phone calls all day and I don't have millions of dollars to get to every single email that's asking for money. But we don't have to be that way as a party. We can be inclusive, saying, what are your talents? How do we use those talents? And what do you want to do? What can you do to help us achieve? Are you a graphic designer and can do lit pieces? What do you do for college? Do you want an extra $20? Can you go do some voter ID for us, you know, at whatever wage it is? There's so many ways to include the younger generations and then get them on board with what our mission and our goal is.
I think Erin Haust is chomping at the bit next to that. Looks like Maryanne might be after that.
You kind of took my thunder there a little bit. We already have the college Republicans on our side. So, yes, use them to the best of their abilities. But we don't have a lot of the high school kids. And they're going to be voters here pretty soon. And we don't have, you know, the folks on campus who are not part of the college Republicans, do we? And one of the things that I think we can do is pay people. And I know that sounds kind of crazy, but on the left, all those people you see at the fair that are standing there with clipboards or that are come knocking on doors, they get paid. Okay? We don't do that very well on our side at all. We rely on one-issue purists to go knock on doors, or we rely on, you know, the party faithful, the folks who've been in it for 35, 50 years, and they are doing knocking on the same doors they've been knocking on for 30 to 50 years. We need to talk to those folks that are not doing that, that are just fresh, you know? So one of the ways that we can do that is you've got somebody who's not paying any taxes because they're, you know, young, and they are working a part-time job. Why not let them, you know, do some things over the summer and knock on some doors and get paid $10 an hour? Why not? Because then they go to their friends and they say, hey, guess what? This guy I actually agree with. He's paying me. Come do this with me. And then they become volunteers later on. And they definitely become voters, and so do their friends.
I think Maryanne's up next. And it looked like Sarah wanted to get in here. So let's go with Maryanne Stebbins.
Well, it's no secret that the young people were notoriously passionate about Ron Paul. And that was because those young people have so much at stake. They are the ones that are going to have to pay back this tremendous debt that we're building up. And they're not fools. They see what's coming. You know, but they are more interested in truly getting government out of their lives. I mean, they were the ones that were all passionate about, you know, ending the Federal Reserve, which is, you know, kind of a new topic that Republicans have been discussing. You know, but they really don't want the government intervention in their own lives. And, you know, that may manifest itself in the wars, because these are the ones, you know, that are typically the ones who have to go to war, are younger people. So, you know, I think if we can, as the Republican Party, stop taking this position that we have to, you know, absolutely go to war and get involved in every overseas conflict, that's something that's going to strike home with them. But also getting the government out of our lives in data privacy, you know, the NDAA, the Patriot Act, a lot of these things where Republicans, we need to be presenting ourselves more as the party of actual less government, reducing the scope of government in our lives, not just in financial issues, but in all of these issues. And that's where the young people are going to come on board with us.
Sarah Janecek. I'll let people applaud.
Okay, the question was how to attract people who are not Republicans who are young people. And so a lot of the discussion doesn't apply. And I say that as someone who lit dropped for Republicans as a kid for 19 cent Dairy Queens. I was a YR, a CR. I've done every job in the state Republican Party possible. So how do we appeal to the young people? I think Maryanne pretty much hit it on the head. And Andy's going to hate this too, but look at the demographic data of the wave that's coming. Younger people don't care about the social issues, and younger people grow up around, look at the numbers, and I didn't bring an iPad, and I'm happy to follow up with something on Facebook, but I think where Ron Paul really appealed to young people was on the social issue, on the fiscal issues that Maryanne just described.
I think Dan Severson wants to get in here next, and then we can get to Andy Parrish.
Well, you know, part of, I think, what we're experiencing in our educational institutions is a socialization. I mean, we've got our public schools have become a machine that is socializing to socialist values. And so we've got to have some pushback. I'm a big advocate of education choice, of vouchers. You know, actually giving the parent the ability to choose where those children go and have a voice in that process. That's part of it. We got to fix our educational system because they are programming our kids. They aren't teaching them. Now, the other thing, and I always take exception, is too, you know, when Maryanne says that some of our guys and gals have to go to war. No, they don't. In fact, the people that go to war are those that step up to the plate and say, you know what? America's free. I have an obligation. And those are the ones that are going forward because they believe that a freedom isn't free, that it costs a price. And, you know, we have minorities who have been here in this place, and they've been invited by the Tea Party to come in and give their testimony. Some of them were Hmong freedom fighters over there that fought in Laos to rescue our American soldiers out of there. And you should have seen the testimony that they gave in this place. It was standing ovation at the end of it. It was because they understood the cost of freedom. They were willing to put their lives on the line for that freedom. And so when we get this whole deal about, you know, America needs to spend less on military spending, yeah, they can probably do a little better. But the bottom line is, military is what gives us the ability to push freedom around the world. When we lose our ability, freedom.
We have a gauntlet thrown, it seems.
Yeah, that seems like.
I think, we want to get in yet here, Andy?
Yeah, look, Maryanne, you're a phenomenal organizer. I respect you. Sarah, I respect you. But Ron Paul, the influx of Ron Paul people, they came in 08 and the same people showed up in 10. And it's a very limited crowd of individuals. Everywhere where Ron Paul was, I was very intimately involved in the last presidential election. Everywhere where Ron Paul faced a challenge that was not a caucus system or even when somebody organized against him, he lost. And I'll just pose the question, you know, tell me what Ron Paul and his people have won. Name a race.
The hearts and minds of the young people.
But name a race.
What we're talking about right now.
Again.
I care about
that's great.
The movement, and unless we live election to election as
as Republicans. We might win every race in the book as Republicans, but government continues to grow each and every year, and until we change the hearts and minds of the people, we're not going to get anywhere.
But hold on. But it's about winning elections, and I'm just going to ask you again, what race has Ron Paul's and his supporters won?
And Andy Parrish, I think we know the answer to that. And
the answer is none.
Well, there are a number. So, Justin Amash,
just as well as
Rand Paul, Ted Cruz.
Okay, let's just take a deep breath, because that's what we're about
tonight.
We can
add Kurt Bills in that too.
It's a healthy discussion. We just want to keep the knives in here, but then we're going to touch on that. How do we make the different sides play well together, or at least find some common ground later on here? But I know Mark Westpfahl wanted to get in one more time here.
We're 50 minutes into this, and what we keep focusing on is the federal races, federal issues, and the massive overall state issues. What I think we really need to be focusing on a party is the local level, where people's paychecks go to, the local businesses, the local communities that they live in. This is where the majority of our taxes are, and the majority of the laws that they've never heard about exist. I'm on a local school board, and I'm probably going to get in trouble for saying that over the air right now and with reporters in the room. But the thing is, we need to be actively involved in school board races, city councils, mayoral races, county commissioners, because until we get a fundamental idea of what's going on at our local level, we're going to overlook all of these different little factors. And a lot of Republican strategists will say, oh yes, it's the school boards and the county commissioners and our mayoral races that set up the stage for our future legislators at the state level. I don't agree with that. And this is why. Because people expect that, that's the stigma that we have. We have a lot of people who want to run for school board, mayoral races, that stay away because they don't want to be seen as that feeder that's going on. Because they want to be involved at their local level with their own community and neighbors. We need to start focusing on our own communities a little bit more. And once we start doing that, we're going to see that our legislative seats are also going to fall in our favor. And eventually, we're going to have Senate candidates that are going to be able to compete with the super PACs and the juggernauts. But until we get involved in the local level, we're kind of kidding ourselves in a way.
Amen, brother. All right, I'm going to move on to another audience question here. What are the fundamental problems, or maybe a fundamental problem that's facing the Democrats that Republicans can take advantage of in Minnesota? Sarah.
They cannot deliver to everybody they promised. And again, I think what we need to do is focus on reframing the issue. It's like teaching a six-year-old, no, you can't have the Twinkie and the Ding Dong if they made those anymore. You get to choose one. And so this is a time where the Democrats, and again, I think it's healthy for the system when one party controls everything, and this should be the opportunity of a lifetime of everyone in this room, because Democrats cannot deliver everything to everybody who brought them to this dance as the majority. And you know something? What regular people can relate to is Johnny and Julie, who are 6 years old, don't get everything they want either.
Well, if they raise your taxes high enough, they
but they can't raise them that high. They can't. And so this is our opportunity to talk about what the priorities of government should be, and why certain things can't happen. And that's the discussion we should start framing and owning. Because these guys are accountable to, as Andy pointed out, all these different groups that brought them to the dance. They cannot deliver to everyone they promised.
Anyone else? Fundamental problem facing the Democrats. Walter.
They promised from the get-go, and their rhetoric throughout their campaign in recent cycles has been, we're only going to raise taxes on the top 1%, the top 2%, the very super rich, people making over $400,000 a year, etc. Everybody in this room is going to pay more to the government as a result of the policies being implemented by the Democrats. That's a lie. They went back on what they said. That's something that we can leverage.
Dan?
Yeah, I think, in terms of the minority communities, I'm going to speak to a lot of that tonight because that's what I'm passionate about. And part of this process is we've got a very large population of Latinos in Minnesota. And just shortly after the election, Rick Aguilar and some of the Latino Chicano coalition put together a new immigration bill that they were going to do a news conference on. I got some of the senators, representatives to say that they would commit to going to this news conference And when the Democrats heard about it, they canceled it. They said, we're not going to be there, so they canceled the conference. Well, the bottom line is, they don't want a solution to this immigration issue. The reason they don't want it, a solution, is because after that's off the table, these are very family-oriented communities. These are people that value the same conservative values you and I value, and once that's off the table, we have a dialogue. But I'm saying let's not wait until then. Let's engage these communities now. Let's start an aggressive outreach to the communities that actually starts the dialogue now before this takes place. And Rick Aguilar's got a marketing deal that's going on this summer, and it's going to be to the Latino and the marketing community at large. And that's one of the first steps we need to do to begin to break open this treasure trove of conservative votes.
And just from my background, I would say drag any candidate, a Republican candidate, through a Minneapolis or St. Paul public school. There's a Democrat problem. We could certainly stand to leverage. That's my editorial comment here. Okay, given the last question that I got to ask, I think this is a timely one. And this is sums up a number of different questions from a number of different people. How do we get the different GOP factions to come together and work to support endorsed candidates? They definitely were against each other in this last election cycle. And beyond that, how do we go? Yeah, what are the mechanics for getting different factions to actually work together towards a common goal? Anybody want to take that hot potato? Mark Westpfahl.
Just to give some historical context, the Republican Party has always been a faction party. Go back to the Reconstruction era after the Civil War. 75% of the state legislators that were making the state constitutions were Republicans. Carpetbaggers, scalawags, free blacks, former free blacks. The list goes on and on. And they allowed to bicker with each other and quarrel over the 15 to 20%, which lost the ability to create the state constitutions of the southern states. It's nothing new to our party, but we pick up on it when we have big losses. A couple years ago, there wasn't as many quote-unquote factions being talked about because we won the state house and the state, both branches of the legislature for the first time in 40 years. We talk about it when we lose, and it's great. But the thing is, we agree on almost 60, 70, 80, 90% of the issues. We are going to have some people who are, one topic is going to get them so over the edge that they're not going to agree on something else. We're not going to find a Jesus candidate in the Republican Party that's going to agree to everybody, but we damn well better be able to accept a Mother Teresa.
Maryanne Stebbins is up next.
Well, it's not like we just have one candidate running that everybody has to go out and pour their hearts out. You know, we have candidates at all levels. You have, like Mark was talking, city council candidates, you have state senate candidates, congressional, gubernatorial. So out of all those candidates, you know, I might have a pet candidate that I just want to pour all of my time and effort and money into. So it's not that we do have to all put it all out for each and every single candidate. You got to allow that, you know what? Not everybody's going to be passionate about every candidate. Let them go, you know what, maybe I'm not even passionate about my own state senate candidate. I can go two districts over and pour my heart out for the guy I do agree with. So, you know what, let's allow differences. Let's understand that, you know, we're not all going to agree, and that's okay.
Anybody else? Looks like Andy or Erin Haust got a microphone.
Just real quick, I think the answer to that is really simple. Stop publicly eating each other. I mean, honestly, we can have our debates and have our conversations and we can disagree, but if you agree with, you know, someone 80% of the time, don't hold a press conference and say how awful that person is. You know, it's really simple. Just quit eating our own.
Anybody else want to take Dan Severson?
Yeah, and I along with that, I think, you know, there are certain values that we are based on in our Constitution, and I believe fundamentally it's a Christian basic principle of forgiveness. And we go into this contest, and each individual believes passionately that they're best qualified in this process. And when you get through and you lose, it's no fun, I can tell you from experience. But the bottom line is to forgive and then jump in behind the cause. And as exactly as Erin had spoke, it's not bashing them out in the public because, you know, the media is not friendly to the Republican side here, and they pick up on that like a magnet. And so from the heart, the potential for us through Christ is to forgive. We need to embody that as a party.
Anybody else on this question? turn it over to Jeff here. Got another one here?
I do. I got a bunch of good ones, and at the risk of starting new fireworks, this is a two-part question, and I think it's really good and fair. The first half, and this is going to make everybody mad, so listen to both halves before you start yelling. The first half is, will the Liberty Movement refrain from bashing the military? We can discuss foreign policy and spending, but there's no call for the killing Iraqi children rhetoric. The second half is, will the establishment GOP refrain from personal insults such as destroyers and nut jobs that only fuels the fire? And so I think it's a fair question to ask of anybody who wants to jump in.
Well, I hope nobody in the Liberty Movement is bashing members of the military. In fact, a significant portion of the Ron Paul supporters were military veterans. So, you know, we support the military. We don't necessarily support the foreign policy, but you know what? We, as Republicans, we criticize government significantly. We don't think government does a good job in education. We don't think government does a good job with healthcare, rightly so. We don't think government does a good job in so many things. So why would we think that government is infallible when it comes to foreign policy? It is not the military that we criticize. Ron Paul had support from the military than all the other candidates together, just on donations that were reported.
Anyone else?
Mark. I don't speak on behalf of any one of the factions, so I don't think it's really appropriate for me to be answering. The point is that multiple groups will anoint people into each one of these categories and cast labels. And go on Twitter right now, and you can see it happening right now. That's part of the problem that we have. It's not necessarily the questions that are being asked. It's the fact that we like to label each one of our groups so we can promote our own agenda or so we can belittle one group or one set of people. That's the bigger issue to me. So,
and that's where I started with my opening remarks. Let's can the label.
Walter?
That's also where I started with my opening remarks and talking about the difference between the political task and the ideological task. I think one thing that's happened, as speaking as somebody who came into the Republican Party from the Tea Party in 2009 with that surge of activism and energy, I think there's a tendency of people to have this kind of hair on fire emergency mentality that we've got to get in there and we've got to change it right now. And it's got to be changed across the board, and we're not going to take no for an answer. And while that enthusiasm is certainly warranted in many cases, you have to think things through, and you have to take a deliberate strategic approach. The political task of getting support so that you can win elections is a different animal than convincing people that you're right. Being right doesn't mean winning. You have to convince people that you're right, and then you win.
We have a question here. Actually, it was one that tied a number of questions together. How does the Republican Party reach out to and recruit potential voters, members, and activists, and candidates who are members of, for example, minority groups, without resorting to race-baiting identity politics? And I suppose that could be extended to sort of me first, give me stuff politics for any group of constituents. Anybody want to take this one? Walter Hudson.
I think the first thing that you have to do, and sometimes the simple solutions sound the least credible, but you just need to go talk to them, maybe? Let's go talk to them first. Let's go to their community, and that's what the Minority Liberty Alliance has been doing. What Dan Severson in particular has been doing over the past few years, the past couple cycles, is he's been going into the communities where they live and talking to them about the things that they care about. I think, again, we have this tendency to want to preach, to want to teach, to want to instruct. I've heard people talk about, let's get a candidate who can go out and teach people what's wrong with the policies of the other side. People don't want to be taught when they're looking to support somebody politically. They want to find someone who shares their values and will bring those values to the craft of public policy. So we need to go find out what people care about first and then see about integrating that into our party.
So Andy Parrish is ready to go here.
I'm just going to go back to nuts and bolts. I think we need to have candidate training. I think we recruit these people And we don't train them on the basics of a campaign. Here's how you log data. Here's how you would. I mean, data in our, in my business, data is money. I mean, if this was SimCity, data is what I would use to buy things with, because that's the most critical piece of, that we have. And when we properly identify people, we can have proper conversations with them that they care about and that they're passionate about. But if our candidates aren't trained, we're going to continue to lose, because there's a lot more to a campaign than just shaking hands and walking in parades, and there's a whole bunch of many pieces to it, and we need to train them, and nobody does that.
Erin Haust.
Real quick, I think we keep talking about things as if this is in the campaign only. And that's a huge mistake made every single campaign. You know, we go out and talk to them at campaign time, and we keep calling them, them. Oh, for goodness sakes, we're all Americans, okay? Honestly, when it comes to kitchen table conversations, people in your community, people at your church, talk to the young people, get on Twitter, get on Facebook, share things that interest you, and eventually the culture will change itself, and we'll start educating without even actually going out there and teaching. It'll just happen. But we gotta stop all this nonsense about, oh, during the campaign is when we have to focus on these people, for goodness sakes.
Mark Westpfahl.
If we also believe that we're gonna be able to truly turn this around within 6 months, 8 months, or 12 months, I think we're sadly mistaken. We're in a society where we expect and demand things to happen right away. Change takes time, and it's very frustrating when we live in such a social media world to not see immediate change right away. So I'm not saying, oh, it's okay, we're not going to win for a while. That's not at all what I'm saying. But to know that where we need to go, and again, we've come up with a lot of concepts tonight. I don't think as a panel so far, I've really come up with a lot of solutions. And that's one of the reasons why you guys came tonight, is to see what solutions do we have to offer. And again, I don't think we're doing that great of a job right now, because the fact of the matter remains, we don't fully know what our real solutions are. That's the heart of it when it comes down to everybody who's said so far, what is our messaging? What is our messaging? That's our problem. We're having a tough time coming up with what our messaging should be, because we don't have one or two or three things that motivates us as Republicans. We do have 15 or 20 things, and it's tough to narrow those things down to get that focus.
Looks like Dan Severson and Sarah Janecek both want to sound off.
You know, one of the things that Ronald Reagan was great about was painting a vision. He could tell you what you wanted to look for, and then he could focus you on that. And that's one of the things we need to do in these communities, is when we start this dialogue, one of the things we need to tell them is our goal is not just to get your vote. Our goal is to get someone from your community who's passionate about the conservative values that embody your culture, and raise them up to be your voice in the legislature. Raise them up to be in your city council, on your school boards. And so, as a point of application, if you are in a BPOU or you're in a CD, there's a breakout of minorities within that particular district. When you get together in your BPOU, you should have a proportional amount of minority that represent those cultures on your BPOU panel. And if you haven't got them, if you don't know who they are, then go out and find them. Get communicating with them. That's where we start this process. Because what it does in the long term is when you raise those conservatives up from those communities, they're a voice for a long time. They begin to capture that community's heart for conservative values, for the American dream, for the dream about freedom and opportunity, those things. And then when they look, the younger people look at these individuals, these are the ones that are their statesmen that are running with conservative values. They know that that's okay, that that is what America is about.
I think Sarah Janecek is up next.
Okay, I guess I was just struck by the comment about we're not proposing any solutions, or how do we move past that? And it has to do with race and gender identity and all of it. I think it curdles my hair. The most racist thing we hear is what we hear every day from major media and from Democrats is, well, the Democrats have the black vote and the Democrats have the Hispanic vote. Well, screw that. That is the most racist thing, and that's been the conversation. And so I think the solution is, Walter hit at it, others have hit at it, is that we talk to people about the ideas, and it is about public policy. It's not about politics. It's how about we're conducting our lives. And I think for most people, I think Walter just hit it. most people do not want their children to grow up with the idea that their limitation is how much can the government give them. Most people in America still, I think, I'm very close to the Guatemalan community, which seems to be unpolluted by a lot of this left-wing stuff, because most of the ones I happen to know, and so maybe I'm categorizing people wrong, are people who came to the country, worked their frickin' asses off, and are so goddamn pissed off at people who are on the take because they busted their asses for 14 hours a day in this country and worked hard to get their family members here. And so my point is, I ramble. My point is that let's reframe the whole thing and appeal to people not based on race, but based on values and what you want for your family. Do you want the limitation of the government will give you $1,167 a month for life? Or do you want to instill in your children and for yourself that there's a possibility, holy mac, you could go make $2,400 a month in the private sector?
Andy Parrish. Yeah, all of this takes money. And so I mean, we can all think we're geniuses here, and everyone out there can think they're geniuses, but the only genius that matters is the field. And the field is the voters. And so until we start developing ways to get money to do surveys to find out what the field cares about, to give it to candidates that we just trained and teach them how to use it, again, we're in a bad spot. Now, Mark, here's a solution. The Republican Party is an absolute disaster. And right now, we've already taken the ding for being in debt, the party of fiscal responsibility, and you look at all this debt that you have. Look, Wyatt Earp once said when he got off the train in Tombstone, the sheriff came up to him and he said, I'm not interested, sheriff. And the sheriff says to him, I'm here to make money. And the sheriff says, I've never met a rich man who didn't have a guilty conscience. And Wyatt Earp said, I already have the guilty conscience, now I want the money. And the party's already been dinged. Declare bankruptcy on the $2 million, get it done with. It's coming. We can declare bankruptcy on it, yes we can. It's not a corporate in-kind contribution if we do. I know the laws, or I know most of the laws, but we can declare bankruptcy, we can start over, we can destroy Phoenix, because that is just the worst system that we've ever decided to come up with. We can blow the whole thing up and start over and rebuild and give these tools to candidates. Provide training for them. Provide polling data. Provide good data. It's what we need to do.
All right, last word, Mark.
When it comes to the training, what we need to do is we need to actively invite our candidates to share their experiences. We do have candidates throughout Minnesota right now that don't want to share their experiences with other candidates because they're afraid that they might run again and that information might possibly be used against them, or the next candidate might use it to gain a better foothold. We need to do a better job of trusting ourselves within our own party to say, listen, we're going to do this training, but we can't rely on just the state party to do it. We need to demand that our BPOU levels take the initiative to say, listen, I don't know what's going on here. My own House seat, we haven't had in a long time. My own Senate seat, we haven't had in a long time. We need to do a better job of reaching out to the other BPOUs and say, what are your difficulties? What are your strengths? And then adapt those to what we can do good in our district based off of what we have and how we want to recruit. When it comes to community involvement, we don't do a good job of being active in our community until it's quote unquote election time. How many BPOUs and candidates are out there right now actively engaging? And yeah, we're 2 years out, but guess what? We're only 2 years out. So we need, and I'm not saying every single Senate district in BPOU isn't doing this. That's not at all what I'm saying. I'm saying we need to do a better job of collaborating between BPOUs and candidates to say, what's the starting point? Because we have a lot of candidates who come into this going, I'm passionate, I know what I want to do, and then they start a campaign and they go, oh my God, I don't know what I'm supposed to do. But by that point, so many other candidates and campaigns are in full mode for their own campaign. So we need to actively coordinate to say, what can we do better? Graphic design. I keep using that because I am a graphic designer. How can we share those ideas with other BPOUs as templates and modify them to fit what our community's needs are? Fundraising, same thing. What works in Invergrove Heights is not going to work in Carver County. Or let me reverse that. What works in Carver County is not going to work in West St. Paul and Invergrove Heights. But getting those general ideas shared between BPOUs and executive teams and congressional districts, that's how we get that coordination on the ground level at least started. Then we can mobilize the people who want to be involved because there's more of a plan to direct us to what to do.
Okay. All right, I got two announcements before I ask the next question. Number one, last call for questions. If you need a card and don't have a card, just raise your hand. Steve will be walking around. And then I'm told it's a little noisy by the bar and some people can't hear. So if you could kind of keep it down for a few more minutes, we've got a couple more questions. Democrats are better with marketing analytics and social media technology than we are. What can the Minnesota Republican Party do about that?
I'm going to take it right now. I'm not even going to let anybody say anything yet. All right, here's the deal. I'm excited about this question because I think it's really important. We can talk all day long about what our messaging should be like, but if we don't have a tactical plan to get that message out, we're lost. We're dead in the water. So some of the things that we can do right now, and these seem like very easy things, but I promise you we're not doing them, and they do them very, very well on the other side. Number one, start viral videos on Twitter and Facebook. Have your candidates, have your issues, have your whatever it is, make it funny, make it short, 2 to 4 minute videos, teaching a thing, talking about a tax, talking about something, okay? The next thing we can do is advertise on Facebook right now for 2016 elections. 2014, you might even be too late to start changing a lot of the culture right now. But by 2016, boy, we better have some ads going on. Use memes and infographics. If you don't know what they are, get on Twitter, get on Facebook and find out, because if we're not using them, we're lost. The young people are using memes to make points in every chance they get. And then finally, make friends with our local newspapers. One of the things that we also don't do very well is get any kind of media on our side. We don't have a chance with MSNBC. We don't have a chance with some of the larger groups out there, but some of these local newspapers, we can get people to apply for the reporter job that are already in our camp. We can get people to write not just letters to the editor, articles. Let's talk about something great that's happening at a local business and say why the taxes will hurt that person. I mean, there are things that we can do right now, but we better start with social media. We better start with Twitter and Facebook, and if you aren't on it, get on it right now and encourage all your friends to do the same.
Andy, when I study a lot of time on messaging and targeting, we're this election cycle, I saw a lot of candidates using the little Franklin style thing. That's like 10 years old. And the Obama administration, we laugh at Debbie Wasserman Schultz, and we laugh at David Axelrod, and we laugh at Rahm Emanuel and Obama and call them stupid. But they have actually hired some of the best psychologists in the world, and they have taught them words that stimulate certain parts of the brain and how to use them and how to say them. And you know, in comedy, when you plan your comedy routine, comedians plan every single word, they time the syllables, and they use words that start with P because I guess those are the funniest words out there. And again, we're stuck with the dial testing, which is really neat, and I'm glad we're using it, but we have to understand that, like Erin said, what you know, like with social media and other things, we have to get caught up with the times. We have to get the same psychologists to train us how to deliver messages and what words to use and how many syllables, because it matters and it works.
Maryanne, did you have something?
I was just going to tack on with what Erin had some great ideas, but you know, the patch online, you can just go on and blog on there. There are, you know, local cable stations that let you come in and do your own little cable show, so lots of great ideas, but you know, Erin had a whole list. I just know that the patch is one that reaches local communities, and they just let you, you know, run your own blog on there.
Sarah?
I'm going to reserve this for, I hope, for a better question.
Anyone else? All right, Mitch.
Let's see, we did have one, not so much a question, but a remark to get young people to come door knocking. You can do things other than money, for example, food. And by the way, the Baltimore beef sandwich here with the horseradish is a great example. I think we could win with a few of those floating around. More seriously, though, a couple of different questions about the Minnesota GOP and its operations, since there was a discussion about do we file bankruptcy or not. I guess I'm going to compile a couple of these questions together. How do we make the Minnesota GOP a viable, stable, solvent institution? Maryanne jumped on that microphone.
Grassroots. You can't just sit up in an office in St. Paul and, you know, manage everything. I mean,
The Ron Paul campaign was all grassroots. It was people down there in their precincts talking to their neighbors, and there's been a lot of discussion about this. But it's, you know, activating those people right down in their neighborhoods, in the grocery store, talking one-on-one conversations. So you spin that power back down to the most local levels. You know, we had the issue with the RNC, where they're trying to grab more and more control at the very top levels. You saw, you know, the grassroots get steamrolled at the RNC. Tell you what, that put a real damper on the election. I had said at the national convention that, look, this might just cost just a couple of percentage points and just a couple of those battleground states, and it could be the whole election. I don't know if that was it. But I mean, it was that close. But you take that and you spin it back down. We don't have, obviously, money at the party, at the state party level. So we need to empower those local units, the congressional districts and the BPOUs, and kind of hand it back to them. You're going to get a whole lot more done there. You're going to get a whole lot more passion down at the precinct level than you are at the state party level.
Anybody else? There we go. Walter Hudson.
I don't have the organizational expertise to speak to the operation of the Republican Party, but I would like to make this point, and that is that there's a lot that can be done outside of the party in support of it. Look at this event. Look at how packed this venue is. And what we're here to talk about is the future of our party. How did this come about? Was this a decree from on high from the party chair? No, it was Steve Hensley, Real Capital View, Look True North. Blogs are another example of folks just going out there from not even leaving the house, just getting in front of their computer and doing what they can. Yes, absolutely, the party does need to become solvent. There does need to be an operational solution, and I welcome it. But we need to keep in mind that we should never wait for the party to tell us to do something. We need to be active at the grassroots.
All right. How would you convince a conservative Democrat that he or she is really a Republican? Marianne.
There was a rumor that there were some Democrats who were Ron Paul supporters. There's this rumor out there. You know, there were some. And there were a lot of independents that came into the office and volunteered, and I kind of tried to get into their heads. And even after that, running for city council, some of my hardest supporters were Democrats. And you know what? A lot of Democrats are actually fiscal conservatives. It was really surprising. There are a lot of Democrats who actually don't like government all that much. And this, you know, we think, you know, if you listen to Rush Limbaugh, and I listened to Rush Limbaugh for years, you think that liberals are all about statism and big government. There are actually a lot of liberals who believe in smaller government, and I've touched on this already. It comes back to a lot of the civil liberties areas. You know, Republicans can invoke government just as much as Democrats. We think we're the party of small government, but that's not the impression out there. There are a lot of areas. Again, the foreign policy. Hate to keep bringing that up, but that's one. Just like I said, we think that the Democrats, there's no limit to the amount of money they'll spend on education. That's what they think about us when it comes to military spending. There are issues like the Patriot Act. There's the drug issue. There are a lot of issues where Republicans are not the small government party. Just a couple weeks ago, I read that the chair of a committee, a Democrat in Minnesota, was the one to author a bill to ban local police departments from keeping tracking data on people. So on privacy issues, we have to convince them that we actually do want the government out of their lives. Because that's what we want, and that's what a lot of them want. So let's
Maryanne,
get that message across.
Okay. Erin and then Sarah.
Mary, I don't think, with all due respect, I understand where you're going with this, but you didn't convince one conservative Democrat by bashing Republicans just now that they're a Republican. And this is what I'm saying. We have to stop eating our own. For goodness sakes, go out there and... When it comes to how do you convince a conservative Democrat that they're actually a Republican, don't. all you have to do is share with them the candidates and the issues that they're voting on and where they stand on those through conversation. There's two places I'm going to send you. One is We Are Change. If you haven't seen a We Are Change video, go online and find We Are Change. It's an organization that just goes out and literally points out, not necessarily the hypocrisy, but it's just a bunch of young people to go out there with a video and talk to Obama voters and people who say they stand on one side of an issue, and then help them work through the fact that they actually don't agree with Obama, okay? The other place I'm going to show you is Project Veritas. That's another organization that does some videos like that. This is how we convince people. It's not by saying, hey, by the way, did you know you're a Republican? No, it's by talking to them and saying, this candidate over here stands for this and this candidate stands for that. Where do you stand? And now we're not talking about Republican or Democrat. We're just talking about people.
All right, Maryanne, just one sec. Maryanne, you can respond, and then Sarah, and then we'll go back down, and then we're going to move on to the next question.
And I don't disagree with anything you said, Erin. I think those are all wonderful ways to reach people. It's just really hard to do when you had the Republican legislature go in and open budget negotiations with a 12% increase. So we have to actually change our behavior. We can tell them that we are the party of smaller government, how great that is for the lives, and I agree with all of that. But our elected officials are going to have to start acting like it too.
Sarah, and then Andy.
Republicans have controlled both houses for 2 years in my entire adult lifetime. And what did we do with that? And remember, the question was, how do we appeal to a conservative Democrat? We had Senator Amy Koch, Majority Leader, brilliantly out of the box, focusing like a laser on jobs. And then what the hell happened? So we have, folks, some tough love to give her, some tough analysis. That thing went to hell in a handbasket the last few years. And let me just say that next time any Republican leader has problems, can you skip consulting the DFL PR guy? I mean, the story lives on by the inanity of Jeff Michelle and David Hand fighting over Ron Rosenbaum and Todd Rapp. Are you kidding me? That story is still going to live. Because we were so stupid. So when you say to the conservative Democrat you're trying to make a Republican, the conservative Democrat says, you know what, I gave you guys a shot. You were going to focus like a laser on jobs. And what the hell happened? We went down the rabbit hole of social issues. Government grew. Why would I do that? So we're not here to reflect on the past or blast the past, although I've done a pretty good job the last minute and a half. But you know what? We learned a lesson. And I'm not so sure in my lifetime we're going to control both houses again, because we really screwed up. So you know what? Let's focus on the fiscal issues, because look what happens when we focus on the social ones. The last 2 years, the only 2 years we've had the majorities in the state, Senate, and the House.
Andy, and then Mark can close it up.
The question was, how do you convince the conservative Democrat? My answer is you don't, until you've solidified your base. And until you've made enough phone calls and sent enough mail to get your base and get the Republicans out, you don't even bother with the other party. Again, if you get your base out, I mean, in voter suppression, I know, probably get booed, but voter suppression is a beautiful thing. It really is, because that's what the Democrats do. And when we go against the Democrats, it's like going into a boxing ring and showing up with your gloves ready to fight, and the Democrat shows up with a bat and two pistols and hits you over the head and then shoots you twice. And then the referee says you're out because they paid him off. And that's until we get ourselves to that level, don't even bother with the Democrats. No, I'm just going to touch on one more thing. I mean, Maryanne, for being the party of the Constitution, as Ron Paul claims, you should know what's in the preamble to provide for a common defense, and I believe the military is part of that. I will also speak not as a campaign strategist, but as a former Capitol Hill chief of staff, where I will tell you, and I'm going to get booed, so start now, but Ron Paul's foreign policy is the most dangerous thing that I've ever seen for America, and I'm glad that he didn't win.
Well, we almost made it all night. And Andy,
Andy, I think you just got quoted in the paper tomorrow when you said that voter suppression is a beautiful
and
thing.
And let us all applaud the fact that people are were willing to have this conversation, and I was glad to see Andy survive getting booed. Bully on you.
Well, all right. And just real quick, you know, Rachel's not the enemy. You know, all of the reporters that I have dealt with in the Twin Cities have been reasonable and open-minded. It's their editorial boards that aren't, and it's their bosses that aren't. So,
yeah.
All right. Mark, why don't you close us out on this question?
I've been following Rachel's tweets as they go, and for a while I thought I was going to be the one that she was going to say by saying, an hour in, and Mark Westpfahl still says there's no solutions. So in that sense, thank you, Andy, for taking the headline away. My wife and family appreciates that. But again, I do agree with the first part when you answered the question. And again, I'll say when you answered the question about getting social Democrats, you don't. You don't demand that other people follow your views. We're an inclusive party. We're an inclusive people. And until we realize that the Democrats are people too, we can't win a battle. And I can tell you, I've got a lot of Republican friends based off of the Republican Party in Minnesota. And most of the other people that I associate with are Democrats. And we're able to engage in a conversation. As soon as we take it to the next level and belittle them and say, oh, you're wrong because of this, and you know, you should be Republican because of this, and when we attack media constantly, it's not the media. We set ourselves up a lot. We really do. But when we say things and say, I want to hear your perspective, because you get a perspective and you can understand where other people are coming from. I'm a social studies teacher besides that graphic design. The entire concept of social studies is to listen and be inclusive of other perspectives because they have a perspective. They know what happened from their side. If we're not willing to listen to those perspectives, we can't manage ourselves because we're too fixated and focused on ourselves. So you do not tell them, oh, you're going to be Republican because of this or that. You engage in a conversation, and by you conversing, you've invited them in, they've invited you in. That's the start.
Okay. We've had a number of people here, obviously, vocal people from the Liberty crowd here tonight. Kudos on all of you. The question from one of them, apparently, is how do libertarian philosophy and practice inform, in your opinion, where the Republican Party moves next, especially focusing on here in Minnesota? Anybody want to tackle that? Anyone? Anyone?
Well, I mean, the philosophy of liberty and how do we take that? I've been talking about that, and that is, you know, we tend to focus just on the economics, and the economics are critical. But, you know, there are so many other areas where government is involved in people's lives, and, you know, we do a good job, I think, on school choice, and we need to continue to offer people real and tangible ways to get government out of their lives through school choice. You know, but there are a number of other areas, and it comes back to the civil liberties. You know, the drug issue, you know, just a number of other areas where, you know, that we have the government telling people how to run their lives. You know, I think if we're going to be truly the party of smaller government, let's put that across the board. And I think that's where we're going to reach people, and especially the young people. If we're looking into the future, if we're not talking about just living election to election, and we actually want to have a future in this Republican Party, we're going to have to look to the young people. And I think that's where the liberty movement is going to have the biggest impact.
I think Walter Hudson is lined up next here.
Yeah, I mean, I think you have to define or know what the libertarian philosophy is. And unfortunately, I'll say that I think there are a lot of professing libertarians who don't know and couldn't explain to you what their libertarian philosophy is. It kind of goes over a spectrum. What I would like to see is just the concept of individual rights. Let's not even put the libertarian label on it because that's kind of been tainted by our use of it in the language. Let's just focus on the concept of individuals having rights and government's job, sole job, being to protect those rights. That's it. That's all there is to it. And every public policy proposal and every campaign and every messaging idea proceeds from that primary. And we got ourselves a message.
Andy Parrish is up next.
Well, what,
what is a libertarian? You know, I'm a conservative, and I know we have libertarians up here, and there is a difference. A libertarian is someone who believes in liberty confined by the confines of self-law. Okay. All right, so anyway, so I'll finish. So within the confines of self-law, which means if I'm doing something and it doesn't hurt anyone else, I should be able to do it.
We'll do a definition, go around after the event tonight.
A conservative believes in individual liberty within the confines of natural law. And I think that is where we have some, where we break down. Where my party has issues with, or where my faction of people have issues with Ron Paul, is that he just believes within liberty, within self-law. If it doesn't hurt anyone else, I can do it. We recognize natural law. And we just recognize there are things that we don't.
Jeff, I need to bring this up. And again, I've been accused of being a true libertarian, pure libertarian, not libertarian, builder, destroyer, all of that stuff. Again, we're fixated on labels. The last time I checked, regardless of what your thoughts are of the man, Ron Paul is not involved in the state politics of Minnesota Republican Party. I don't care if you like him or don't like him. We need to get over that fact.
Mark, well, if you just didn't hear the response, you'll see that he clearly is involved in the Minnesota Republican Party.
Andy, I'm just curious. The name of this party is the Republican Party of Minnesota. I chose to be a part of this party not because I want to be a part of any faction. I chose to be a part of this party because I see it lines up with my beliefs. My beliefs don't always line up with yours, don't always line up with Walter's. They don't always align up with Maryanne. The point is that when we keep constantly saying, well, Ron Paul this and Ron Paul this and Mitt Romney that and Mitt Romney that, and we keep going on about the issues that are overarching, that are totally, completely out of our control.
Why not start the Liberty Party then?
Did I start the Liberty Party?
No, I mean, why not just start your own party if that's, you know what I mean?
Then those who want to do that should have the option and opportunity to do that. But as of now, whoever is in that supposed movement is in the Republican Party of Minnesota. That's why we need to work together.
I believe the Liberty Party is meeting at the Hog's Breath.
Yeah. Can I just say
that if we have two major political parties and neither one of them can be the Liberty Party, we're in a lot more trouble than we thought.
That's what I meant to say.
And I'll go back to what has Ron Paul and his organization won in Minnesota?
Right.
Name one race.
Andy, we get the point.
One. We got it.
Nice job, all right. We actually have several more good audience questions, but Mitch and I thought that it's probably time to start wrapping it up. So we each have one question apiece to finish this off tonight. So my question for anybody who wants it is... this year we're celebrating the 50th anniversary of Martin Luther King Jr.'s big speech. And when he stood in front of the Lincoln Memorial, he did not say, I have a 7-point strategic plan. He said, I have a dream. What is your dream for the Minnesota Republican Party?
$5 million.
Okay, good.
Walter.
All right,
Sarah.
This is my last shot, right?
No, you get one more question.
I'll get one more question. I do have a dream, and that is that we Republicans, remember I've been talking about let's skip the labels, and by the way, in reference to libertarian, I was called that 25 years ago. That it keeps changing. But as Republicans, let's skip the labels, and let's go back to what Martin Luther King said. Let's judge each other by the content of our character, not the color of our skins, let alone the labels that have been put upon us by other factions in our party. And I will save the rest for my final remarks.
Regardless of what the question is. Mark, and then Walter.
Dr. King was not talking about government. If you read his speech and you take a look at the context of what his speeches were historically, he wasn't talking about government. He was talking about communities and people. And there are multiple communities and there are multiple groups of people that can join together regardless of their political affiliation. I mean, there's a lot of people that believe Dr. King was a Democrat. He wasn't. He voted for more Republican candidates than he voted for Democrat. But that's not the issue either. We tend to overanalyze what we want to hear without hearing that additional perspective. in my dream, my wish for this party is that we can start coalescing at all levels. We don't have to start at the grassroots level. We don't have to start at the state executive level. But once we start communicating with each other at various levels and reaching out and trusting other BPOUs and sucking up our own pride and saying, I need help. I need your help to make my BPOU better. I need your help to make my candidate better. That's my dream, is that we can get to the point where we can stop all the other silliness and say, how can I help my area better by using you?
Walter?
I think that the turmoil between the factions within our party is somewhat endemic of what we're projecting out to the rest of the world, people outside of our party, so that we come across as just kind of foaming at the mouth and divisive and antagonistic, and we're having a fight and we're having an argument, and don't you want to join us? No, I'll just go about my business having a peaceful night with my family, thank you very much. My dream for this party is that we learn to first understand and then to project the positive, morally good, life-affirming philosophy that undergirds our policies. Individuals seek out values. They seek out that which is going to perpetuate their life, help them survive, and improve their quality of life, help them thrive. And the only way you can do that as a human being is if you are free to act upon your own judgment. That's unique to human beings. Animals act on instinct. We have to think about it. We came up with the clothing and the buildings and the lights and the electricity. And if you're not free to do it and free to profit from it, humanity does not progress. We need to take back the progressive word for our party.
Boy, it's hard to follow that. I love Walter. My dream is more for a movement than it is just for a party. The party, as long as I've been in it, has always lived election to election. And we're always told, look, we have to vote for this candidate who believes in bigger government because we have to get that candidate elected. So my dream is what I've already been working, you know, with so many Liberty people, is that we need to be changing the hearts and minds of people, one on one on one. Because until we actually change the perspective, and until people actually want to live free and understand that they can do that without the confines of so much government, we're not going to actually realize our dream and our stated purpose of in the Republican Party of having less government. So my dream is more of a movement than it is just partisan operations.
Well, I'm going to ask one more question here. I think we're going to do it. But before we do that, I wanted to get a word in from the person who pretty much just on his own hook went to organize this whole shebang here. The guy who organized the entire event here tonight, please give a warm welcome to Steve Hensley.
I hate public speaking, and I haven't had anything to drink like all of you. But I see Kurt Bills over there, and I am not one of these Liberty Republicans, and I don't have any problem with them. I was standing next to Doc Severson and Pete Hegseth when Kurt took the stage to accept the nomination last year in St. Cloud, and I shook Doc's hand, and I shook Pete's hand, and then from that moment on, I was behind Kurt Bills, and gloating here, I was actually named his first volunteer of the week, so thank you for that, Kurt. But I think everyone who is physically able should stand up and thank her for running a good campaign.
And, as much fun as it is to talk and think and theorize about politics, of course, much all respect due to the people who actually go out and campaign, like Mr. Bills, like the apparently three different candidates for state GOP chair that are in the room here tonight. Of course, it takes a lot to go and put it all on the line like that, so kudos to all of you and everyone who's running for any kind of office. So I'm going to ask one last question. Ronald Reagan used to say, in not as many words, focus on the things you agree on. Don't you rip yourself apart over the things that you disagree on, but focus on the things you agree on and run with those. So I'm going to ask each of our panelists to step briefly outside of their faction, whatever it is, if they have one, and tell us what they think on behalf of the rest of the party that you all agree on. What do you think that your corner of the GOP agrees on going forward? What can we build a party on going forward here? I'll start with Maryanne.
Well, I hope that we all agree on economic freedom. You know, we at least are supposed to be the party of fiscal conservative. So on that, I feel confident that we agree. And then there are other areas, such as school choice. So there are areas where we do agree on freedom besides just the economic. And so let's look at those. I appreciate that Doc brought up school choice. I'm a big advocate of school choice. And I think if we can all work together to come up with ways to sell that to the public, you know, giving parents the right to choose their children's education, let's work together on that. That would be a big benefit.
Mark Westpfahl.
I still don't know which faction I'm supposed to belong to, so do I get to answer from all perspectives? No.
It gives you an advantage here.
I think what we need to look at is... Come back to me.
I'll make a note of that. Dan Severson.
Yeah, I think, you know, our founders were amazing men. They were amazing because they knew all the religions, they knew all of the governments of the world, and yet they came up with a constitution that said that we are endowed by our Creator with certain inalienable rights, among those life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. That God is the giver of those rights, and government has no right to take those away from us, particularly when this is a government governed by the consent of the people. And so for us, I think we need to drive that home to every American, that these are rights that they have, and that government is the only threat to those rights, and to put government under the consent of the people once more.
Sarah Janecek?
I'm going to pass and come back to me, please.
Oh, gosh, I'm going to have to keep track of people now. Walter Hudson.
Yeah, I'm good to go.
Make Walter go last. Nobody wants to follow Walter.
Exactly. That's why I was like, I'll quickly go.
Walter's gone.
I might let Walter wrap the whole night up here at this rate.
It'd be a good objective. You don't want me going last. I think what it boils down to is the fact that we can all agree that government is more intrusive in our lives than it should be, than it needs to be, and than it constitutionally is. And once we agree on that, then we can start coming up with these concepts that we've come up with and put them into an actual action plan to make solutions, not only for the Republican Party of Minnesota as a faction, but at the community levels, at the BPOU levels, and for our candidates themselves.
Okay, who is next? Walter, okay, here we go.
Come on.
I'm gonna make my answer a little topical and reference immigration. There was a time in this country where the reason to come here, the only reason to come here, was to be free of the tyranny that you were leaving behind in your country of origin. And when you got here, there was no guarantee that there was going to be food or water or health care or retirement or anything other than land and trees and air. I think we can agree as a party that we still believe in the pioneering spirit that brought those people here in the first place. And we want to get government off not just our backs, but everyone's back, especially those who we would consider, who are generally considered to be disadvantaged or lower class or in need. Because they, more than anyone, need that hope that I can build something, I can achieve something, and I don't need somebody else to do it for me.
have Andy Parrish now, or do we trade that away for a future draft pick?
No, I mean, Walter's a brilliant guy, and I love his policy, and I love his philosophy. He's one of the libertarians to me that is reasonable and makes sense and can communicate with me. Not saying that they're all not, but Walter knows how to connect with me. So, you know, what can we agree upon? I think we can agree upon that we need to get back to the very basics of campaigning. And we need to get back to the very basics of having a party that actually has money, that provides a database, that provides training to candidates. You know, I'm guilty of this at times. I'm probably going to contradict myself, but that's okay. I'm not elected. I wish we could first say whoever our endorsed candidate is for office, once that person's endorsed, we're going to get behind them. We're going to give them everything that we've got, and we can have the policy discussion later. And, you know, it goes both ways. A lot of people on my side, the quote establishment, you know, we didn't get behind Kurt like we should have, and he suffered from that. A lot of people on Marianne's persuasion didn't get behind their candidates the way they should have. And I think that if we decide first, we're better off with Republicans in office, and then fight about the policy later, we're going to be better off. But we've got to give the support to the candidates that they need to win in the first place.
Erin Haust.
Can you repeat the question?
I don't know. What do we all agree on?
I'm just kidding. I think what we can agree upon is the fact that we agree probably 80% of the time, right? My hope, I looked at this panel as more of a tactical thing from my perspective, being someone who's in social media quite a bit, somebody who writes a blog and is out there. I wanted to look at this from the perspective of what can we do moving forward versus looking back. And one of the things I really think we can do going forward is just shut up. We need to stop bashing each other. Stop eating our own. Stop just this crazy argument of, well, you're a liberty person and you're an establishment person. We are all conservatives in one shape or fashion or another, and we're all Americans. So I think just in closing, I just wanted to say, you know, thank you for letting me be here, and I thank everyone for giving me the opportunity to be more of a tactical side of things versus a philosophy side. I appreciate that.
And I think the last one on my to-do list here is Sarah Janecek.
All right. The question you started with, Mitch, was a Reagan question. Is that correct?
Yes, it was.
All right. And so I will go back to what I said an hour ago, and that's to remind everybody what Ronald Reagan talked about for 8 years, and it was mostly economic issues, although he was a social conservative. But remember Lee Atwater, who tragically died of a brain cancer really young, and his big old tent. And I tell you what, the moderate GOP caucus was not a caucus of one like it is now. There were a lot of people. We've lost those all. Lost a lot of them. And why? Two things. One, there's a litmus test. I love what Andy said, but you can never get any Andy's help unless you pass his litmus test. I think a lot of moderate people have worked for a lot of social conservatives because they didn't give a rip. They thought those issues would get resolved some other place, but they were concerned about the fiscal ones. The second thing, this conversation about libertarianism has been fascinating to me in all this get government out of our lives, because, and I'm glad there's major media here, because let's all understand how this works. Every time somebody talks about, as a libertarian, and I'm the first to say I'm a libertarian, get the government out of our lives, government should be fund things that we collectively need to do together but cannot do alone. But every time we have that conversation, it's like, oh yeah, but they're in the bedroom. You know, and so we know the game. And I guess that goes back to my pisticity factor at the David Hands and the Jeff Michels of how that game was played. We understand how the media work. I've been on all sides of this game. And we know 95% of major media think left. We know how the argument gets framed. That's fine. That's fine. That's why I kind of love the new media. And what I love and what people hated about me when I was in the media business is you knew where I was coming from. And you know, so you know what? Read me that way. It's called critical thinking, people. And that's the way we should read everybody who's a mainstream journalist. But we just have to understand the dynamic that we're given. The game is changing, and there will always be a role for major media. But remember, every time you say something stupid as a as a conservative Republican about getting government out of our lives, remember, you're going to get it back in 85 flame comments in the Star Tribune or the Pioneer Press about, yeah, well, the government's not out of the bedroom. So let's just be careful about where we're going, and I end where I started. Let's skip the labels, let's skip the litmus tests, let's focus on the economic issues for a while, and I think that takes us to the majority.
Sarah, I think I learned three new words from you tonight. I'm not going to repeat them.
Well, you know, I think that's part of what's required in a bar. Fair. After 7 o'clock, talking about GOP politics is that you have to throw in a few...
Fair enough. One thing that we missed that I think we can all agree on, in 2014, Al Franken and Mark Dayton kind of need to go. All right. I think we're done. We are good as a party at debating, maybe fighting. We always have been. We always will be, because I think we actually appreciate being able to discuss ideas. And we did some of that tonight, but I actually feel good because I think where we ended up was a realization that our true foe is not within the party. It's not the Liberty people. It's not the establishment. It's not the Tea Partiers. It's not the moderates. It's the Democratic Farmer Labor Party. And if we keep that in mind, I think we're going to have a great 2014. So thank you all for being here tonight, and thank our panelists again. Thank you.